So I don't know if you're tired yet, but I've got one more lecture in me. Are you all ready to go? I'm gonna put it all out today. So I'm gonna sleep on the plane for sure. But I'm not ready to slow down yet. So I want to engage in the topic of generational dynamics, and especially in the Asian American church context, a little bit of background of how I came to this, to the study of this. And the material that I'm speaking about draws from the 8th and 9th chapter of my first book, The Next Evangelicalism, where I talk about a case study of the Korean church and second generation ministry as the examples of next evangelicalism. The latest book that I had the chance to edit, Honoring the Generations, is out on Judson Press. And that was kind of a collaborative work where we looked at generational issues within the Korean American or Asian American context. So some of the stuff at the end, I'm going to draw from that material that is in the new material. But the initial impetus for me to study the Korean American church in particular came actually just out of my own experience. So I grew up in an immigrant church, and I was very shaped by that experience. Obviously, I became a Christian through the very powerful ministry of the Korean immigrant church, the very dynamic youth ministries that were around during that time and still are, the very important centrality of youth ministry and young ministries, young people's ministry in the Korean church that I grew up in. But then I went away to college, and I began to be a little more critical, maybe hypercritical, of my immigrant church experience and began to become... You know, you would never know this about me, but I can be a little cynical at times. And, you know, that cynicism began to slip into my view of the immigrant church in particular. And so I had that going into college and my experience in college. And then it probably got amplified actually in seminary for a number of different reasons. For one, my story as an immigrant was not really elevated in the context of my evangelical seminary. And so you kind of gravitate towards the dominant narrative of that evangelical seminary, which is the Western cultural theology. And you idolize that Western cultural narrative, and in the process of doing that, you diminish your own narrative. And so just kind of being very self-critical, and who was it that used this term? Greg Howe used this term of InterVarsity, that we Asians have a real high sense of self-loathing. And so we tend to kind of diminish our story because, James? Zoe, you were here earlier. The suffering professor. You know, he was reminding us that oftentimes within even our own communities, we end up diminishing our stories, maybe because the dominant story is such an oppressive presence that we sometimes diminish that. So when I was doing my THM, I really said, you know, I really need to take a look at my own community instead of just being critical of it, to actually say, well, what do I know about that story? I know of the story of my church, and I saw all these splits, and I saw all this dysfunction, and I didn't like the way they emphasized this and didn't emphasize this. And so, yeah, I can be critical of my own kind of experience in the immigrant church, but what's the largest swath of what it means to engage the immigrant church? And then as me as a second generation Korean American, how do I operate out of the blessing of that immigrant church experience? And that's the background of my research. And so those who've read Next Evangelicalism, the critique that I get oftentimes, and a justifiable one, is that my chapter on the emerging church is extraordinarily harsh. And yes, that is true. But my chapter on the Korean church, immigrant churches, is kind of a softball, that I'm not being as critical as I could be. And that comes from Korean Americans who come to me and say, yeah, you didn't really tell the whole story there. You didn't tell all the garbage that goes on in our church communities. And that was deliberate, because I felt that that's such an undertold story that maybe it's time for us to hear some of the positive elements of it, because even within our own Asian communities, we tend to be hypercritical of our own stories and maybe diminish the role of that in lieu of wanting to kind of glom on to the evangelical, white evangelical story. So I'll give you a little bit of the background. And again, I'm focusing on the immigrant church story in the Korean context, and realizing that there are differences in the Chinese story and the Japanese American story and the South Asian story and the Southeast Asian stories. There are a range of experiences within these, but this is my topic of study, with the Korean church and how we see the Korean church as... the Korean American immigrant church as a great example of evangelism in the American church. So just a little bit of background. Most of you are familiar with this. In 1965, the immigration laws changed. What had been an immigration that has focused almost exclusively on European immigration now shifted under an act that Ted Kennedy had, was the first bill that he ever sponsored through the U.S. Through the Congress In fact, if you know anything about Kennedy's career, the last bill he wanted to get approved under his name was the Kennedy-McCain bill to immigration reform, the comprehensive immigration reform that Kennedy-McCain proposed before McCain ran for president. And then when he ran for president, he pulled the bill and didn't want to do it. But Kennedy really saw these two as kind of key landmark issues for him, that he began his career. The first bill he proposed was the 1965 immigration reform. And then the last bill he wanted to reform was the comprehensive immigration reform. So 1965 changes the way immigration is done. The emphasis had been on Europe, but then it shifts more into African, Asian, and Latin American immigration. Is now the doors are open. Now we still have a quota system, and the quota system is still in play, but the adjustments and the distribution within that quota system is now a little more balanced. And so this is when you begin to see post-1965, the immigration, larger waves of immigration coming, especially from places like Asia, some in Africa and a lot more in Latin America. But Asia is the continent that we see with a larger wave of immigration post-1965 with the immigration reform. So looking at the Korean-American community, about 800,000 Korean-Americans came to the U.S. between the years 1965 and 1990. So those are the critical years that I want to investigate, the decade of the 70s and the 80s, where we saw this massive influx of Korean immigrants. There was a little bit of a tailing off that occurred, but then a spike again when the IMF crisis hit Korea, and there was kind of another wave of Korean immigration that occurred. But the 70s and the 80s were the kind of the heyday. So the 2000 census, I think, had it at about 1.2 million Koreans in the United States. This is reflected now in the church growth in the Korean immigrant church as well. So you have, generally speaking, a highly churched immigrant group coming into the United States. And the assumption is that that transfer growth is what contributed to the high number of Korean-American churches. It is true that half of the Korean immigrants had some kind of Christian background. But that by the end of the 1990s, when we looked at Korean-American immigrants, anywhere from 70 to 77% of Korean-Americans attended church regularly. So that is a significant spike. It's not just transfer growth. There's some kind of conversion growth that is occurring here when almost three quarters of your population is attending church. Again, the emphasis there is attending church regularly. In 1970, there were only 75 Korean churches in the entire U.S. Can you imagine that? Because there's 75 right in this neighborhood now. But in 1970, there were only 75 Korean churches in the United States. By 1990, there were 2,000. By the year 2000, there were 6 million Korean churches in the United States. You almost believe me, right? No, that's not true. I made that number up. But there's a lot of Korean churches in the United States. It's like, oh yeah, 6 million, that sounds about right. Write that down. There are actually about, I think the last number I saw was about 8,900 Korean churches. I think that was a number in 2006, Korean churches in the United States. So you are clearly seeing this exponential growth of Korean churches in the United States. I think, and it's hard to document this in any sort of real way. If you look at the most significant evangelistic efforts in U.S. history, it is not Billy Graham. It is not the seeker-sensitive movement of Bill Hybels. It is two things, I think. The first is the conversion of African-Americans post-Civil War in the Mississippi Delta. Very undocumented, but probably the most significant evangelistic effort ever occurred, because that community saw about 80% conversion within a generation post-Civil War, post-Emancipation Proclamation. The African-Americans in the Mississippi Delta had this incredible wave of conversion to Christianity during that time. And the other one is this undocumented, uncovered evangelism and great church growth that we saw here in the Korean community, where about 40% of Korean-American immigrants become Christians after they come to the United States. So my question is, how did that happen? And what are the factors that led to this tremendous growth and tremendous evangelistic effort in the church, in the Korean church during this time period? I looked at five factors, and these five factors, I wish I had this, my slides on up here, but just list them and go over them. The first is language as a factor of the church growth and culture. And you can kind of put those in the same category, language and culture, because that usually meant that was the way you kept Christians in the church. So you have a church in that language and in culture, so that when people come to the United States, they find a church in their language and culture. So those are the first two reasons. The third reason is community, network, social connections. The fourth reason is the provision of social services, by the church. And the fifth reason is the social status and worth that is offered by the church. Now, let me say right now that if I put on my sociologist hat, those are the reasons that I would give. When I take that off and put on my clerical garb or my theologian garb, then I say, no, it's clearly the work and move of God that brought the revival and movement of God and the growth of the church among the Korean-American community. But then when I put back on my sociologist cap, I can say, well, that's true, but we also left see the social factors that led to the growth of the church in the Korean community. The first two, again, fairly simple and straightforward: language and culture as a necessity. You come from Korea to the United States. You're already a Christian. You're not going to go to the church down the street that has all their services in English. You're going to look for a church that is a Korean-speaking, Korean language congregation. That stands to reason, right? I mean, every immigrant group has done that in some form or another. The Italians look for churches that are conducting the mass in Italian. The Spanish speaking congregations now. I think I once gave this example, and I said, and the Irish had their services in their own language. Wait, the Irish speak English. So what you end up with is every culture comes into the United States and look for services in their own language, especially if you're bringing your faith with you and you want a German-speaking church. And as I said, I'm in a denomination that has a long history of a Swedish heritage. And so the first churches that the covenant started were Swedish-speaking congregations. And so you have this transition from one culture or one location to the other, and you want a service in a language that is the one that is the language for you. And I mentioned this in another setting about, you know, my mom is 80 years old, but throughout her life, she spoke English in a broken English in a blue collar job, working the service industry, 20 hours a day, 6 days a week. And she needed that just one lousy day where she could speak Korean. Just that one lousy day. So it doesn't make sense for me, even as I'm an English-speaking, multi-ethnic church pastor, to force my mom to go to a multi-ethnic church. That's silly. She needs to be in a Korean church because 6 days a week, she's operating in a foreign language, and that one day a week, she gets to operate in her own culture and language. So there's this kind of connection. And again, some of it is self-explanatory and obvious of language and the growth of the Korean immigrant church. Kind of an interesting side note, I happened to be at a conference for Korean-American students conference somewhere, and I happened to be sitting next to, I was a workshop speaker, another workshop speaker who was the director of the Korean schools nationally. So he kind of oversaw the curriculum and helped out as a network for the Korean schools. So these Korean schools are teaching young children, Korean kids, the Korean language. And he said that there are about 300 of these nationally. This is several years ago, so I'm sure there are more now. But he said there are about 300 of these Korean schools, and only one does not meet in a church. The other 299 actually meet in a church. So you see that very tight connection between language and the church. You can also talk about the culture, that you celebrate one's home culture in the context of the church. Some do, but most Korean churches, the meal of choice is not macaroni salad at these meals. It's not, it's not a tuna casserole. That's not kind of the meal of choice. It's going to be Korean food. It's going to be kimchi. It's going to be the very wonderful diet of the Korean food, because that's part of the culture. Amen. So I had a friend who was doing research on shared space, and he was looking at churches that shared space. And one of the major things was that there were a lot of Korean churches, as you know, share space with other churches. And this is kind of early on, that was particularly the scenario. And what he found some very interesting things. And he looked at churches, Anglo churches in particular, who were sharing space with the Korean church. And generally speaking, the Anglo church said, we have no problems with this church at all. They're wonderful. We have different times of services. They're growing. We love what they're doing. And the only complaint was what? The smell of kimchi in their refrigerator that refused to go away. So that was the one complaint that seems to come up. So again, a reflection of how much the culture is embedded in the culture of the church, and how that culture kind of comes out in the church's culture. But then we shift a little bit more. Okay, so language and culture explains the transfer growth. So if half of the people coming from Korea to the U.S. are coming here for linguistic or are coming to the church and they look for a language and cultural reason to go to church, they're going to go to the Korean church. But then you get into the other three categories, which seems to be a little bit different. So the first is the idea of community and social connection. and how the Korean church provides support for the alienated and ethnic. And the way the comparison that I draw is it's very similar to the Black church, where the Black church is the social network, right? If you want to be in community, you go to the church. So that's why many of our African-American leaders, and not as much now, but certainly not that long ago, many of our African-American leaders are also pastors. You can think about Walter Fauntleroy, who's a pastor who was the delegate from D.C., Reverend Jesse Jackson and his son. You know, these are folks who are church folk. Floyd Flake, who was a congressman from New York, was also a pastor of a very large AME church in New York. So we're seeing how the network is really rooted in the church. Your entire social network is found in the context of the church. Oftentimes, we find Korean churches that are really extended family networks. I was part of a Korean immigrant church plant, and we started the church initially with about 15 people. We met in the pastor's living room, and then at the first service had a lot of people, but the second service, we already had like 100 core people. And I was like, where did all these people come from? Well, it turned out one of the core members that helped start the church has a really extensive family network. And so the next week, there were 40 people that were all related to him somehow, showed up. His cousin, his uncle, his sister-in-law, you know, all of them showed up. And now all of a sudden you have a church that has grown like, you know, 200%. And all of that is kind of cousins and uncles and aunts that have showed up at the church. So the church operates very much like an extended family. One example that I've used on this is if you're a Korean American and you don't go to church, you have no friends. I mean, that's just kind of the social reality of a Korean immigrant experience. I share this story about my uncle, who my mom's brother, who my mom has been trying to, she's the first Christian in her family, trying to witness to her family. And, you know, they all kind of reject her and she, but she came down to, okay, I have older siblings, but I have one younger brother. And so as the older sister, I'm going to really lead him to Christ. And so when he moved to the United States, that was my mom's project. I'm going to lead this, my younger brother to Christ. And of course, it didn't work. I mean, you know, older sister telling her younger brother to go to church, it didn't work out at all. And he had a lot of bitterness towards the church and a lot of bitterness towards God. But it turned out that, so about a year later, after my uncle had moved to the United States, I come home from college and I ask my mom, hey, how's uncle doing? He says, oh yeah, uncle's doing great. He's been going to this church for the last 6 months. I said, well, what happened? Well, he's going to a church. He said, yeah, he realized that, you know, he wanted to go fishing on a Sunday and there was nobody to go fishing with. He thought he could go golfing on a Sunday, but all the people he would golf with are at church. So he decided to go to church and just, you know, hang out and find a golfing buddy at church or a fishing buddy at church. And actually, they're going to make him a deacon next month. So you're seeing this really kind of important social networking occurring in the context of the church. The other part of that is that if you are a Korean American immigrant and you've never been invited to a church, there's got to be something really wrong with you, because every Korean is invited to go to a church at some point. If you ever go to a Korean grocery store, what is the one common thing on the way out that you see? Come on, Koreans, you know, you go to the Korean grocery store, Korean restaurant, what do you see just along the entire wall of the Korean grocery store? Sermon CDs, amen. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. The entire wall of the Korean grocery store, sermon CDs and brochures for the local church, because every Korean is invited to go to a church. So what you're beginning to see is this kind of primary central role of the church in the social life of the Korean American immigrant. The fourth category that they talk about here is social services that the churches provide. The churches are oftentimes operating as immigrant reception centers, and usually that falls quite often on the pastor. The pastor is not always, but oftentimes the best English speaker in the church, especially in an immigrant church. And so as the pastor, you're called upon to do a whole range of social service activities. For example, you are called upon to translate immigration information that comes from the INS, or you're called upon to communicate on behalf of the parishioners who doesn't speak much English. The pastor would do that. So the pastor is very critical in providing social services. I've seen this kind of translate into other cultural groups as well, where I was having lunch with a good friend of mine who pastors a Brazilian church in Boston. And we went to a sushi restaurant and we're having lunch and we're kind of sharing our stories. And every 5 minutes he gets a phone call. It's really annoying. Sometimes he'll look at it. Sometimes he'll answer. Sometimes he'll put the phone away. And I said, I mean, what's going on here? I mean, we're supposed to be having this nice lunch together. Every 5 minutes, you're getting a phone call. He says, oh, this is nothing. I get more phone calls than this. I get hundreds of phone calls a day. So, well, what's so important that they call you for this? Well, the last person that called me reminded me that I needed to go and bless his business because that's what I need to do when he's opening a new Dunkin' Donuts. I need to go over there and bless his business. So he asked me to stop by. The call before that was that they're trying to fill out their immigration paper and they need to come over and translate for them. So I need to stop by and do that sometime this afternoon. And you don't believe this, but the call before that was one of my parishioners asked me whether I should get Sprint or Next Tell. And so these are the calls that an immigrant pastor will handle because the pastor is the social worker for these immigrant churches and the church as a whole tend to operate in these very high level of social services. You saw this quite a bit in the Korean church where one of the ways that social services provide is actually youth ministry. This is one of the most important social services that Korean churches provide because Korean immigrants are working long hours, working two jobs, and their children are not being supervised. And so one of the most important hires of a Korean church is the youth pastor who will always, without exception, have a Friday night meeting for their youth because that's the social service offering to their youth, Korean youth to say, well, we want to get our kids not on the streets and hanging out in some street corner. We're going to get them into the church on Friday. That's a very important social service because you're providing that service to the parents as a social service to the parents. I know of churches in New York and this is from one of my classmates at Columbia. His dad was a pastor, and he was telling about how his dad's church had grown so fast. And I said, "Well, how did your family do this?" And he said, "Well, here's the scenario. I got into Columbia, and they started advertising in the neighborhood that." That if you want to send your kids to Columbia, and what Korean kid in New York doesn't want to go to Columbia, I guess. If you want to send your kids to Columbia, then what you need to do is you need to come to this church where the pastor sent his son to Columbia and come to this tutoring program. And so they had a tutoring program from 3 to 6 where they tutored Korean immigrant kids to get ready so they could get into an Ivy League school. And that is actually how they grew their church. So you see, again, this very tight connection between social services, and maybe that only works with the Korean churches that are obsessed with Ivy League schools. But what you end up with is these Korean churches providing a very strong social service on these multiple levels. So that's kind of the fourth category. And the fifth one was an intriguing one for me, the idea of social status. And that the Korean church provides a social status. And again, I go back to everyone is invited to a Korean church. If you're not being invited, there's something seriously wrong with you because everybody is invited to a Korean church multiple times. But the other part of the social status is that you have a significant number of individuals in the Korean church who were maybe managers in Korea, who were white-collar workers in Korea, who actually might have bachelor's degrees or even master's degrees. And when they come to the United States, they end up, you know, making deli sandwiches, right? Or they end up, you know, working at a dry cleaning store. So there is clearly a very significant social status drop. And that occurs not just for Koreans, but in other communities as well. But it's really felt when you think about, well, I was a manager of a company in Korea, or I was on my way to getting a doctorate, or I had just finished my master's degree, and when I come to the U.S., the only job I can get is to run a dry cleaning store. So there's that real sense of social status loss. And the church then becomes a place where that social status is recovered. And leadership development occurs in the church because you don't get that elsewhere. So I don't know of any Korean parents. There might be some, but none that I know of personally, any Korean immigrant parent who is a member of the Rotaries or the Key Club or the Elks Lodge or the Lions Club. Now, those things just don't happen in the Korean community. So the leadership development that happens in the Korean church is in the context of the church itself. And that's where you recover. So there are two different numbers on this that during that decade that I'm talking about, either anywhere from 27 to 32% of the church had some kind of official leadership position. That's really high for a church to have that many official deacons and elders in a church. Almost a third of the congregation have some kind of official leadership. Why is that? Well, you've had this real loss of social status. And how does that get recovered? By becoming a changnonim and a chipsanim at a church that restores some of that social status. And the social standing you have in the Korean church is going to be helpfully making up for the loss of social status in American society where you're just a clerk or, you know, someone who owns a dry cleaning business or works at a carryout. So the church helps to restore that identity and status loss because of immigration. So you have these multiple factors. The immigrant church then operates as one who provides these sociological supports that draws people in. So the church becomes not only a theological center and a place of spiritual community, but it is also a place where social services are offered. Now, what happens, though, is that the immigrant church can start to see themselves then as a place where services are provided, and therefore begin to perceive themselves as a mission field, the immigrant church as a mission field. So when you think of yourself as a mission field, you operate under a certain paradigm and rubric, and you view yourself as a needy mission field. So the immigrant church, in fact, and then when you compare that to the eyes of the dominant culture, that's great because now we have marginalized and created this category for these immigrants. So the immigrant church becomes the perfect mission field to the missionaries of the dominant culture, because that mission field is a lesser sister needing our support and needing the help of the dominant group, but is also a mission field that is successful and can be boasted about within the denomination. But at the same time, it is also a separated church, with the exception of the kimchi in the refrigerator, that requires actual minimal contact between our church and the mission field church. So a couple of the factors there is the idea of boasting about the church. When I first got to Boston, I was in a gathering of Methodist pastors. And the Methodist pastor was, some of them were talking about their churches. And as you might guess, Methodist churches in Boston are in severe, severe decline. In fact, every single Methodist church in the entire state of Massachusetts has seen attendance decline, except for one church. And that one church was the Korean church. That was actually seeing growth in the Methodist church. But it was amazing how much that church was propped up as, hey, our churches are doing well. Look at this one Korean church that is doing well. And so you can boast about that within your denomination, but ultimately it's kind of still an alienated group within that denomination. So when we look at these five factors of church growth, language, culture, community, social connection, social service, social status, and worth, the question is, and again, I want to honor that story. I want to say this is something very powerful that the first generation did. And when I talk about, for example, justice for the second generation, how the second generation can engage in acts of justice and maybe do kind of the more compassion ministry, justice ministry as a second generation, I say, well, don't look at the dominant culture model. Look at your own story. Go back to the first generation and see how they live self-sacrificially. Look at the ways that they served one another. Look at the ways that they, you know, and some of it was kind of, yeah. Look at the ways that the first generation Korean church really worked to care for the least of these. It just happened that the least of these were right in their church community and actually made the effort to do so. So when we shun our background and our first generation story, we end up leaving out a very significant portion that could inform where we go from here. So that the second generation needs to embrace this part and say, wow, the first generation did some amazing things here. They built a church out of nothing, and they took care of the poor among them in a very powerful, healthy way. And that's why we have the growth of the church that we did. But then the question becomes, how do we now move into the second generation? And how does the second generation pick up this narrative? Well, there are a couple of obstacles here. The first is, hopefully, by the time you get to the second generation, the language and culture issues are diminished, right? So now in the second generation, you're English speaking. You know at least what it means to engage with a majority culture. You know, we sent these kids to Columbia and to Harvard and to Fuller and all these great schools. And so our children, the second generation, know enough of the majority culture. We've sent them through the educational system here. And so now we have the assumptions of the second generation doing better in terms of assimilation to the larger language and culture. But then the question becomes, why then do we still have second generation churches? Why do we still see the continuation of second generation immigrant churches? And you know, we have to know the narrative that some have not worked out very well because of the generational conflict. Some have worked out okay. Some have worked out well. But the question is, why does it still feel like there is a need for the second generation to have either their own communities, whether you look at the proliferation of ethnic-specific Asian-American ministries in so many of our university and Christian colleges and the campus ministries. You just see the proliferation of these ethnic-specific groups, especially among Asian. Well, that seems to indicate that there's a hunger for it. There's a need for it. The growth in more recent years of Pan-Asian churches or second-generation Asian churches, the growth of EMs within the Korean American context. So it seems like even though the rationale and the explanation is different from the first generation, there seems to be enough of a motivation for the second generation to stay together, whether that's in youth ministry or college ministry. And now when you get even to kind of beyond that, the second generation who are now 20s, 30s, 40s are still in some cases staying together as a community. So one factor that I want to touch upon here, and then I want to shift into how this might contribute to the larger multi-ethnic discussion, is the concept that I picked up from Eldon Villafañe, who is my mentor. And I mentioned this in a previous lecture, that my understanding of my own racial identity as a Korean American has been best informed by my experience of intersecting with Latinos. That's an important part of my development in my Korean American identity, that I heard the story of the Latino community and the influences from Eldon Villafañe, Humberto Alfaro at the New York Theological Seminary. These are very key mentors in my understanding of Asian identity. So Villafañe goes back first to Du Bois and Du Bois's concept of double consciousness. Most of you are familiar with this idea of double consciousness. The fact that the African-American, Du Bois is kind of talking about in his book, The Soul of Black Folk, the African-American identity is living in two different worlds, the double consciousness world. So the African-American goes into the majority culture context and needs to dress a certain way, maybe speak a certain way, eat certain foods that are not necessarily a part of his or her culture. So you adapt and you adjust because you are living in a world and a context that is not necessarily your own context. But the African-American leaves that workplace, goes back to his or her neighborhood, goes to his or her church, goes to his or her networks that are kind of based within the African-American community, and enters into another consciousness, another level of awareness, cultural awareness, et cetera, so that you're operating in these two separate worlds, but you know how to do that. You navigate, you're able to navigate between these two different worlds. And so you go into corporate America and you dress a certain way, but then when you go to church on Sunday, the clothing looks very different. You eat the foods that are available in these corporate America setting, usually very much drenched with mayonnaise and lots of egg products. So that's, you know, you do that because that's what you have to do in that particular cultural context. But then when you come back to the your home culture, then there is a different set of foods that you have. So you are developing this capacity of double consciousness. Eldon Villafañe, who's a second generation Puerto Rican American, English speaking, says that that concept translates well to second generation Latinos, who have a triple consciousness. And he develops this alongside of Virgilio Elizondo, who kind of has similar kind of ideas here. But what they're looking at with Latino identity is that if you're an English-speaking Puerto Rican American, you have a triple consciousness because, one, you have to deal with majority white culture. And again, same thing with a Black American. You go into these contexts, you dress a certain way, speak a certain way, act or behave a certain way that it's appropriate for majority culture. But then you go back to your home church. And in this case, for the second generation Latino, you go into your Spanish-speaking congregation. And you feel at home there, but you're not completely at home there. In the same way, you go into majority culture and you're at home there, but you're not completely at home there. So now you go to your parents' Spanish-speaking congregation and the food is familiar, the language is familiar, but that's not really your spiritual home, your emotional home. Where you're emotionally home is in the triple consciousness, the third level of consciousness, which he describes as there is a new culture or a new consciousness that develops that is a reflection of that immigrant experience as a second generation Latino. So you share that experience, you share that life story with other second generation, and that's where you feel the most at home. Now, that has a very easy translation for me to the Asian American community, where as a Korean American second generation, I know how to interact with majority culture. I know what it means to go to an all-white school or an all-white gathering and to fit in and to dress appropriate for that cultural context. But I also grew up in the immigrant church, and when I go back to the immigrant church, this is not a foreign place for me. I'm not completely at home there, but I know what's going on there, and I could still be in that context. But where I might feel the most comfortable, where I may feel the most at home, is in my third consciousness, my triple consciousness, and that is with other Asian Americans or second generation individuals who have at least some kind of dynamic that is mutual with me. So, you know, we can talk about this transition from first to second, and we understand the language there. We can talk about what it meant to grow up feeling ostracized from our peers because when we invited our friends over, they held their nose and said, oh, your house smells funny. You know, we know these stories that we have in common. We remember, you know, how our dads embarrassed us by wearing those black socks with those sandals and the Nebuk shirt. You know, those things are stories that we share in common with one another, and therefore now we have a consciousness, a relationship that is based upon this kind of shared consciousness experience where we can, again, feel at home, but not completely at home in majority white culture, feel at home, but not completely at home in the Korean immigrant church. Where we might feel the most at home is with those that are similar to us. I want to translate this into what is happening on the larger scale. So I narrow it down to the Korean American experience. And you can say there are similarities, as I said, to the Latino second generation experience. It's differences, but there's kind of this narrative that seems to be emerging. There's also similarities to the Chinese American experience. And we saw this when our church was working with Haitians in our congregation. The immigrant story was replaying itself. So there were a couple of incidents when we were working with the Haitian congregation. One, the enforcement of Haitian Creole upon their children. So we had a children's ministry that had Haitians and Brazilians and Koreans and kind of a wide range. And we did everything in English because that was the common language. But the Haitian parents got really upset after a certain point and saying, we want our children to learn Haitian Creole in their church context. So they pulled all the kids out of this children's ministry that was a kind of broader base. And I flash back to, wow, that reminds me of when I was an 8-year-old and my youth pastor says, okay, we have to stop speaking English in our church now. And we have to do everything in Korean. You have to learn, you have to memorize the verses in Korean. You have to, you know, recite the passages in Korean. And that's what I remember when I was a teenager, of that kind of enforcement of language, you know, Korean as the language that you have to use. So there are these kind of similarities that develop across the cultures. And this is what I'm kind of grappling with or dealing with. If our theme of the next generation, whether that's Korean, Chinese, all these other cultures, then that experience of triple consciousness and that journey from the prior generation to the next generation is enough of a common narrative that it should include not just Pan-Asian and not just Latinos, but does that describe the entirety of the American experience right now? So that there is a common story that we are beginning to share, and that is the common story of journeying and navigating through a generational shift. So if we were to look at kind of dominant Anglo culture right now among evangelicals, there is a legitimate concern about this shift from the Enlightenment modern principles that drove evangelicalism for the last several centuries to a shift to a more postmodern driven evangelicalism and there's a lot of confusion about it. But they're certainly on this journey of transition from modern to postmodern. And that's a very real experience that I don't want to discount at all. It's a very discomforting and jarring experience to move from a Christianity so rooted in modernity to the point of captivity to now transitioning to a more postmodern ethos, a very real journey. I've seen among my African-American colleagues this transition in a different form as well. And that is kind of movement away from what I talked about, the Mississippi Delta experience and the conversion that occurred there, to that kind of the Black Southern church experience that is still very prominent in many of our African-American communities. the South Side churches of Chicago still are following patterns of worship that we saw maybe 100 years ago in the Mississippi Delta. Are we seeing that kind of narrative that is very powerful and justifiable in the Black community, the old Black Southern gospel Baptist type of worship? But now are we seeing a transition from that narrative to, I don't want to use this phrase flippantly, but is there more of a hip-hop narrative that is a response to the previous generation? And there are different categories that come with that, but my friendship with Dan Hodge and Phil Jackson and Ephraim Smith, who are working on this area and kind of embodying this in the churches that they lead, we're seeing, are there within the African-American community the transition away from the more Southern gospel, a Baptist experience to a much more of a hip hop type of expression? And is that journey also something that the Black church is experiencing along with the journeys of the Latino and the Asian American experience? And in these journeys of these generational journeys that are occurring, is that where we find the commonality across the different cultures? And yes, the narratives are different in many forms. And yes, the experiences are different from community to community to community. But the fact that we are on this transitional journey, could that be a shared journey that helps us in our triple consciousness?